Yeah, still so many people have to come. Okay, let us wait for. So I'm going to start the class at 11:10. When is your exam? Can you please tell me, because I need to prepare our question paper as well. So good morning, students. Welcome to the today's class. Today, we are going to look at the Xilinx Rewarder tool. which is used for implementation of our designs. That means if you want to write some codes, if you want to simulate and synthesize your code. So for all these things, so, we can use the reward of Jylinks tool. Okay, so fine. So what is there in this one? Let us look at this one. Okay, so all of you know that whenever we are using the CAD design, for example, okay, so we have started off using a PCA design flow, right? A PCA design that we are doing, right? So in the previous class, we told that for any design, whatever the design you take, for example, any digital circuit, for example, if you want to design some digital circuit, right? Digital circuit. So what we have to do if you want to design a digital circuit, we have two approaches are there. One is, that means the designing part we can do by any means. Okay, so many methods are there, but we want to implement this digital circuit. Okay, if you want to implement your digital circuit, we have two possibilities are there. One is a dedicated hardware is required. So what is the dedicated hardware means that, for example, I want to realize a full adder, for example. Okay, for this full adder, if I want to realize, I need to consider the exclusive OR gate, AND gate, OR gate, I'll consider and put it in the breadboard. And I want to consider that is dedicated to the full adder only. Okay, so whenever, but if you want to change the full adder configuration to another application or another digital circuit, I cannot use the existing full adder circuit for to change to decoder. Okay, so that means that digital circuit is dedicated to perform the full adder operation only. another one is called programmable devices are there. Programmable hardwares, I can say that. So what is this programmable hardware will do? Is that, for example, if you have realized the full adder, okay, you have implemented the full adder. After some time, you want to implement the half adder. For example, if you want to implement the decoder, then what we can do is that you have to reprogram that hardware. Okay, then that will be acting as a decoder. So therefore, programmable hardwares are nothing but general purpose devices. Okay, so it is not a dedicated one. Okay, so whatever the programmable hardware is there, it's not dedicated to only one particular functionality. A number of functionalities that can be done. Okay, so therefore available. So what are the different available programmable logic devices out there? Okay. What are the different programmable logic devices we have seen? Of course, we know that, okay? Sorry for this. I'm using a different board. That is the reason why it is showing this kind of problem. Okay, anyway, so here we can see that one is ELA. We have one programmable device is there. Another one is EAL. We have another one is CPLDs. Okay. The third one is FPGAs. So these are the available programmable logic devices that are available in the market. Okay. So therefore, these are general purpose hardwares which can implement any function. Okay, it is not dedicated hardware. We can implement any function. Once if you implement one function, after some time you can reprogram that one, and so that it will be acting as another function. Okay, so that's what the thing. So in most of the cases we talk about, as the complexity of the system is increases, these are not sufficient to utilize, these are not sufficient actually. So therefore we have to go for field programmable gate arrays. So therefore, the field programmable gate arrays that we have to consider in our class. Okay. So therefore, this is called FPGA design. Also, people will call as FPGA design. Okay. So whatever the design is there, the design has to be implemented on FPGA. Whatever the design you do, so that must be implemented in FPGA. Okay. Then that can be considered as a realistic device. Okay. So then now, what is there in the FPGA? As all of you know that. If you consider the PLA or PAL or CPLD, it can considered as the basic gates, right? Basic AND gate, OR gate. Okay, so AND gates and OR gate, or maybe which can be implemented. Most of the cases, AND gate, OR gates that we have to consider, we have to use. Okay, so as the complexities increases, these are not sufficient to do this. We have to use FPGAs. There, we have to consider combinational logic blocks, CLBs that it consists. Okay, so this FPGA consisting of CLB. What is a CLB? CLB is nothing but it constitutes of lookup tables, LUTs. It constitutes of lookup tables. Okay, the CLB is actually one logical circuit. That logical circuit consisting of LUTs, not an OR gate. Okay, it's a memory place where we can store our information. LUTs, LUTs consisting of memory field. And multiplexers. LUT is consisting of memory fields as well as multiplexers. Okay, so these are the things that are available in CLB. Therefore, number of CLBs we can see in FPGA. That's what we have to identify. Okay, therefore, these CLBs we need to program according to your design. Okay, so what is the biggest advantage of using this FPGAs? It is nothing but reprogrammability is there. So for example, you have a full adder that we have implemented here. After some time, I want to implement a subtractor, full subtractor. Therefore, we have to erase the content of this full adder information and use the information of full subtractor, for example. Use the full subtractor. Then this FPGA can be acting as a full subtractor. Okay. Similarly, like this, a number of functions can be implemented by that. Okay, one of the FPGA kit is I'm showing here. Here actually the middle of this one, this is called an FPGA. Okay, this is an FPGA. So these are all the necessary peripherals which are connected to the device. Okay, so therefore the heart of this FPGA, this kit is actually an FPGA. Okay, we have to program this FPGA. Okay, how do we program all these things? We will see later on. Okay, so therefore Xilinx is the company. Not only Xilinx, so many companies are there, but popular thing is the Xilinx FPGAs are most popular. FPGAs are most popular. And Artex is also there. Artex is also there. Those are also an important FPGAs. A number of companies are come with FPGAs, but we focus mainly on Xilinx related FPGAs only. Is it clear? Now, the question is, what is the process flow that we have to use when we are using the design? For example, this is the end FPGA. Okay, therefore this is an FPGA. If you want to, whatever you have designed something, if the design must be dumped into your FPGA. So if you want to dump in this one, we have to follow some procedure. Okay, so what is the procedure? So this procedure is as shown here. First, we have to design the thing by using the design entry methodology. Okay, then we have to synthesize your design. Then we have to implement your design in an FPGA, and just you have to program it. Okay, so program is nothing but to provide the connections among the components. That's all. It is not a software program. It is a program here stands for providing the necessary connection among the components. Okay, that information we have to give it as a file, bit file, we normally call it as. Just you have to give the bit file where the components need to be connected. That information give it to the FPGA, then FPGA will provide the necessary connection and it will be acting as intended function. Okay, let us look at what do you mean by the design entry. Okay, as all of you know that. So the design entry is nothing but, so how do we view your design? How do we view your design? Okay, for example, I am considering the full adder. So this is the full adder is my digital circuit. How do we view this one? So there are the two ways are there. We can view it by using the schematic. Okay, so by using the schematic that we can do it. Or so, or otherwise, a language that we can use. Okay, the schematic that we can use it there, or language we can use it there. Okay, so therefore, the schematic representation of your design is very, very complicated. As the complexity of the system is increases, the schematic representation of your design is complicated. Therefore, it is better to go for HD language representation of your design. Okay, the language representations are done by using the HDLs. Hardware description languages. Okay, by using this hardware description languages, then we can represent our design. So design entry is nothing but the representation of your design. That's all, nothing more than that. Okay, next, we need to synthesize our design. What do you mean by the synthesizing our design? Whatever the code, or we can call it as a program. Here we normally call it as at the design entry, the program stands for set of instructions to describe your circuit. Okay, that's all. At the end, programming FPGA stands for provide the necessary connections by using the bit file. Okay, but here the code or the program is normal notation of giving the instruction of the description. Okay, so what the synthesis there is that it is translating the program into actual circuit. So therefore, what we are doing is that, so FPGA is there. So we can view this one by using the language HDLs that I'm using, right? So it is actually a set of instructions, right? We have written the code module, something like this we have done. So that must be converted into real hardware. So what is the hardware here is actually, for example, AND gate, OR gate, all these things will be there in this one. So the translation of the textual information into a gate level circuit or a netlist. Okay, schematic it can produce or netlist it can produce, netlist. It both can be possible by using the synthesis tool. But in broad sense, you have to identify that synthesis is nothing but translation of your code into actual circuit elements. So the circuit elements consisting of AND gates, flip-flops, some multiplexers and other components, right? So that is called synthesizing of your design. Next, implementation of your design. So what we have done, yes, whatever the textual information is there, yes, fine. So that is converted into gate level circuits. Okay, somehow I have written the gate level implementation of the design, something I have done. Now this must be implemented in an FPGA. So the FPGA consisting of CLBs, right? CLBs. So n number of CLBs are there. Now, how these basic gates are converted into CLBs form? Okay, so that is done with the help of implementation. It requires some certain kind of processes involved in this one. What is the process here is that translation involves in this one, mapping of your design is required, placing and routing is required. Okay, so therefore how the synthesized code or gate level netlist disk is translated into this an FPGA CLBs, how it is mapped, whether it is mapped to this particular CLB or this particular CLB or this particular CLB, where it is to be connected, okay, and how the one CLB is connected to another CLB or within the CLB, how the components have been connected. That information, that thing will be done by the implementation process. That is done by the implementation process. What is the problem? So LUT stands for lookup tables. Lookup tables. LUT stands for lookup tables. Lookup tables. So therefore, we'll discuss this lookup tables later on. Okay. Okay. Just only point you have to remember is that FPGA consisting of combinational logic blocks. This combinational logic block consisting of lookup tables. Okay. So therefore, the translation is existed during the process called implementation. Once the implementation is done, then we have to program. Then we have to program. Okay, so therefore, we have to program in the, is that it has to generate the bitstream file. It is a set of zeros and ones related to which CLB have to be connected, which lookup table have to be connected. All this information is there in the bitstream file. Okay, so therefore, once the bitstream file will be generated and give it to the FPGA, FPGA will be acting as your the resource, it will be acting as your intended circuit. Okay, whatever the circuit that you want to implement, that implementation can be done. Right, so now the question is that as we have seen that, yes, the design entry is there, so design entry. From the design entry to synthesis that we have done, from synthesis to simulation, that implementation that we have done. Okay, so all these things we are doing. So how can you show that the design entry is correct? Design entry you have done. How can you say that whatever the design entry that you have done, whatever the language that you have written, whether that is correct, portrayed your design or not, we need to check, right? Whether whatever the design description that you have done, whether that is producing the real circuit or not, we need to check. That means here we need to check your the HDL code, right? Similarly, we need to synthesize in our code whether it is correctly translating the HDL code into hardware or a gate level netlist, or I can say that the schematic or not. We need to check here also. Okay, so therefore here also we need to check whether the translation is correctly done or not. Okay, so once that is checked, then again implementation have to be done. That means whether translation is correct or not, mapping is correct or not, routing is takes place correctly or not. Okay, or whether it is meeting all the timing related issues of the CLBs that is existing in FPGA. All these things we need to check here also. So therefore, that means at each and every step that we need to know that we need to check the whether the particular process is done correctly or not. Okay. So for that one, we are going to use the terminology called simulation. So checking the translation whether it is done correctly or not, we normally talk it as simulation. Broad sense. Okay, therefore, the simulation can be done at design entry, the simulation can be done at synthesis, the simulation is done at implementation. Okay, therefore, the simulation we are doing at the gate level, okay, so sorry, at a data entry level, normally we will call it as a behavioral simulation. I can say here, actually. So this is called behavioral simulation. Behavioral simulation. So after the synthesis we are talking about, this is called post-synthesis simulation. Post-synthesis simulation. Okay. This is also a simulation, okay, simulation. So similarly, we can say that after the, so here we mainly focusing on, here we are mainly focusing on language constructs, whether it is following the language construct properly or not, we need to check. Okay, and of course, at first end that we can say that by applying the some input signals, whether you're getting the output signal or not, we need to check it here. Okay, without constraints, without constraints. Okay, that, what do you mean by the constraint? I will discuss shortly. Okay, so with constraints, we have to do the same thing with constraints. With constraints that we have to go to. Okay. So with constraints, we have to do the simulation that is called post-synthesis simulation. So here we don't want to bother about, so without the timing issues, without timing issues. Okay. So with the timing issues, with the timing issues, if you want to do the simulation after implementation, this is called static timing simulation. Static timing simulation. It is called static timing simulation. So therefore, these are the technical words people will use. Behavioral simulation we do at the design entry. Post-synthesis simulation we do after the synthesizing of your code. Static timing analysis we do at the implementation time. Okay. So these things we will do with the lab tool. Therefore, I'm going to discuss shortly. So again, I have discussed about a brief discussion about the behavioral simulation. This is also called RTL simulation. The behavioral simulation is also called RTL simulation. What is this main thing that it has to do? It's a very fast simulation. Okay, it identifies the functionality of the design without constraints. That's what I told you previously. Okay, the functionality of the design means, for example, if you are having the full adder, apply the input signals and identify whether the summons Cout is producing correctly or not. Okay, so without using any constraints. Okay, so and we have to do this simulation frequently in order to identify the logical faults existing in the circuit. Okay, so whenever we have certain kind of faults, logical faults existing in the circuit, we have to do this one. Okay, frequently we have to do this one because it is a very fast simulation. We can do at any point of time after discussion of your circuit. Okay. Okay, the next one is do the simulation. Next one is called post-synthesis simulation. So the post-synthesis simulation, functional simulation, this is also called functional simulation. Here we talk about mainly on the constraints. What do you mean by a constraint? For example, whenever you are designing some full adder, for example, full adder, we should know that we can constrain this the area of this full adder. How much area that you want to design this full adder, that we can tell to the tool, okay, this much area is required for me to do this. Okay, so you can also say that this much power must be consumed by the device. Power consumption can be another constraint in this one. The next one is delay also can be another constraint. Therefore, you can give your requirements, not only the functionality of a design, you can also say that, okay, this much area, this much power consumption, this much delay has to be produced by the for your design, for the design. So whether these constraints are meeting or not, that is also verified. So not only the functional simulation, not only the functionality of the design, it can do the constraints also. Constraints can be done. Okay. So therefore, these two things can be done by using the post-synthesis simulation. Okay, and this is done at the netlist level. Okay, netlist is nothing but a gate level circuit. Okay, it is nothing but a gate level circuit. It's normally gate level circuit is called netlist. Okay, so that means the program is entirely, actually, when we are talking about the synthesis means HDL code is converted into hardware. I'm right, I'm sure, is it clear? It's a hardware it is generating. So actually, it's not hardware. Actually, it is also generating another program, another program. Okay, but this program must be in gate level. So that is what the simulation tool, synthesis tool will do. Okay, so normally it can be a data flow model, it can be a gate level model, or it can be a structural model, or it can be a behavioral model. Whatever the modeling style that you have used to describe this one, it doesn't matter. But the synthesis tool will convert this one into a purely gate level netlist. That's a very, very important one. Okay, actually, this is what actually the basic definition for the synthesis. Okay, for readability purpose, for user purpose, it is generating the hardware, something like this. It's actually generating the hardware, something like this. Therefore, the two options are there. It can generate the hardware in this form, or it can generate the hardware in the form of a netlist. Okay, so therefore, this gate level netlist is a basic for the other processes. Okay, so therefore, that's what we do. So therefore, you have to keep on your mind that synthesis is always generating the gate level netlist, irrespective of whatever the design entry that you have done. Okay, fine. Next one is implementation. So at the implementation part, we have to consider the timing issues. That means setup time. Okay, setup time or hold time. Okay, is there any other slack that we can calculate? So therefore, these are the different timing issues that will be resolved or that will be checked at the implementation time. So this is called, normally people will call it static timing analysis. Static timing analysis. So this is done at the implementation part. Okay, once this is clear, then only it is possible to implement your design in a FPGA. Otherwise, you may not get the design constraints according to your you cannot meet your constraints, whatever you have framed. Okay, but it is a clear-cut picture. It will be identified at the timing simulation only. Therefore, whether your design is accurate or not, that is identified at this level only, and it takes a long time. Actually, more detailed discussion can be done with the in this particular simulation. Therefore, it takes a longer time. Okay, you can observe that behavioral simulation is very fastest one, and constraint post-synthesis simulation is also done moderately, but timing simulation takes a lot of time. Okay, because it provides much more detail. So detailed discussion will be produced by Drew. Okay, so the simulation will be produced. Right? So these are the different implementations that we can do. Right? So this is what an FPGA design. Okay, so this is what an FPGA design. So what we have done in an FPGA design flow. So this is a very simplest approach that I have done. Okay, in an FPGA design flow, what basically consisting of, the first one is design entry that we do now. Design entry. So far we are describing the circuits, right? So in order to describe your circuit, we have to use the technique called design entry. So next one is we are going to synthesize your program. The third one is implementation. Okay. So in this class, we are going to talk about the first design. How do we describe your circuits? Okay, and we can do the simulation. So RTL simulation or behavioral simulation. That is the second thing that we do. Third thing is synthesizing your program. So implementation, all other things we'll see later on. Okay, so we mainly focusing on design entry, synthesizing your code, and the simulation of your design. That's what we do normally. Okay, then of course, in this design flow, we have to program. Okay. So timing simulation is nothing but, so somebody is asking the timing simulation. So timing simulation. So the timing simulation is nothing but we are verifying the timing issues related to your design. Okay, for example, you have an FPGA, for example, right? An FPGA. FPGA. Okay, so it consisting of different logical blocks, right? So for each and every logical block has got its setup time and hold time. Okay, setup time and hold time of each and every device will be predefined. Okay, so you have designed something, but you have given some constraints related to the delay. Okay, so delay you have given. Okay, so from input to the output side, for example, input to the output side, only the 1 nanoseconds delay is required for me. That's what you have given the information. Okay, when you are translating this design into an FPGA, so that 1 nanosecond time, that means it has to meet the setup time of the device exist here, and that meets to the hold time of this one. Altogether, this 1 nanoseconds must be involved with satisfied the setup and hold time of this particular device existing in this one. Okay, so randomly or knowingly, desired purpose that if you are giving the 1 nanoseconds, that 1 nanoseconds may or may not be meeting the setup and hold time of our existing devices in FPGA. Okay, that checking, verification can be done in the timing simulation. So therefore, this is normally people will call it as static timing analysis. Okay, so identifying the timing issues of your design. Yeah, so this is what we do in FPGA. Fine. Next, I'm going to demonstrate the lab tool so that you can understand how we can perform all these things by using the tool. Okay, because we are not going to implement our design in FPGA. Because real time, I cannot show you the FPGA kit and how to dump this one. But the only thing is that how, by using the CAD tools, how do we entry our design? Okay, how do we simulate our design, and how do we synthesize our design? Okay, three things that we want to do it here. So by using the CAD tool, I'm going to use the design entry. I'm going to use simulation. I'm going to use synthesizing output. Right? That's what we do. So now I'm going to share my screen. Just a minute. Quickly, I want to demonstrate everything now. So I have a Xilinx software with me. So I am opening the Xilinx software. Just a bit. So this is a Xilinx software. I hope you can see this one, right? So this is the Xilinx software. This is actually the Xilinx is producing a number of simulation tools. Earlier it has an ISC simulator. Now they have come with the Vivado tool. Okay, so this Vivado tool is meant for, this is allow us to describe our circuit. Okay, yes, for simulation, synthesis, and implementation can be done by using this simulation. Okay, fine. So in order to describe, that means how do we describe our circuits with the help of this tool? Let us see now. First of all, we have to create a new project. Okay, just double click on create a new project. Here, the new project will be pop up. Go to the next. So we have to give the project name and the project location. Default, I have given like that only. If you want to change this one, you can write verilog DDBL. I think it's better to write DDBL underscore 4 3BG. 3BD. Okay, so the location is the same, and this is an RTL project. So as I mentioned that whatever the design description is there, that is actually under the RTL project. Okay, we can do other things also, but I don't want to do anything here. Just after some time, I will do. Just click on three times. Then we have to mention what kind of FPGA that you want to take. Okay, so I am going to take product categories for all the purpose, general purpose I'm considering. Okay, family is Ertex family. Okay, and then subfamilies. Actually, in our lab, we have Ertex families here. Ertex Xilinx are available. Okay, and the package is actually CPG235. So, FTZ, that means package is nothing but whenever we have an FPGA, all the sites of an FPGA, we have a pin configuration, which pin where it is available. All the pin configuration is available for that FPGA can be identified from the package. Okay, the speed value -1 I can consider. All these things, no need to worry about it. Okay, so this is what an FPGA I'm considering. FC7800FT is FPGA. FTZ256 is the pin package. -1 is the speed grade. So we have to select that particular FPGA. That FPGA consisting of input-output pins are 256 pins are available. Input-output buffers are 170 buffers are available. It consisting of 63,400 lookup tables are available, and 126,800 flip-flops are available. ROMs this much available. DSP processors are available. So many. So the huge amount of the logic will be incorporated in an FPGA chip. Okay, so but we don't want to use everything in that one, only some part of that one we will use. Okay, okay, so this is the design process summary. I have chosen FPGA, this one, Ertex family I have considered, speed and everything. Now it is creating the project folder to me. Okay, and this is the environmental place where I'm going to see my designs and everything. Okay, I want to. Okay, now we can see the flow navigator. Flow navigator is nothing but if you want to design the FPGA design flow, normally the people are calling as flow navigator. It consisting of a project manager, IP integrators, simulation, RTL analysis, okay, synthesizing, implementation, and then program or debugging. So these are the steps that we have already seen briefly in our FPGA design flow. Okay, so now the question is, in a given folder, I'm going to create my source file. Source file is nothing but a very log file I need to create. And that means my program I need to create. So for that one, add source that I have to do it here. Okay, and then add or create design source. Default that is there. Just yes, I want to create the design source file. So just we have to click to the next. Okay, then here you can see the plus symbol. Just click on the plus symbol. Create a file. So what file that I want to create? For example, half adder. Okay, HA is the half adder. That is what we are normally working on, that one. Okay, half adder that I'm doing. So therefore here, HA.V, that means this is the file name. So .V stands for Verilog file. So therefore, just we have to finish the thing. So it is asking that input outputs, if you want to mention here or not, it is asking. I'm saying that no. After some time, I want to do that one. Okay, it's asking that you did not mention anything. No problem. Now you can see here, our design is something like this. HA is our design. Okay, just click on the HA. Double click on the HA. You can see here, you have a skeleton of your program. You have a skeleton of your program. Just you have to do all these things. Okay, so these are all the comments. So if you want to keep it okay, otherwise you can remove these things also. You can remove this one. So time scale directory should be there. Okay, otherwise you are not able to provide the information. We will discuss that time scale directives later on. So this is what our program, the skeleton they have given. FA, default FA has come. Why? Because I have given file name as FA. Of course, it taken as module name is also HA. Okay, does not matter, doesn't have any matter. Okay, next. So A is my input. Of course, everybody knows that. Sum, carry, okay. I'm doing in this way. And out of all these things, inputs are, see, you can see the keywords are in a different color. Okay, so that's the reason why I'm using the different colors for that one. Okay, input is actually A comma B. Okay, next output is sum comma carry. Right. Now, what is the best choice that I can write a program for the hop adder? I think data flow is sufficient, right? Assignment state I can write.
I think so.
Assign. Okay, yeah, assign S is equal to A XOR B. That's all. Okay, next C out also I need to write. Assign statement I need to write. C is equal to
A and B.
Okay, that's all. Okay, this is how I have written the code. Okay, so this is called design entry. People, please identify that this is called the design entry. I have design entries completed, and I want to check whether the program constructs I have done carefully or not. Because here you can see assign is a keyword, I need to write properly. For that one, wedlock operator I have to use. So I have to use the semicolon for after completion of each and every statement. So these are called language errors. If there is any language error, is there that we have to check. So if just by save this one, it automatically tells you that if there is any errors or the errors are there or not. Okay, so I cannot find any kind of errors here. So errors can be seen at the bottom. Okay, so I cannot find any kind of errors here. Otherwise, it will show you. I want to produce one error here. For example, semicolon I have not put here. So I'm saving this one. So you can immediately see some kind of errors. Warnings here, you can see the warnings. So two critical warnings we have. So what are those critical values at this bottom that you can see? In the bottom that you can see some TCL messages here, you can see here. Some two critical warnings are there. In the messages, you can see that one. Okay, so some kind of errors are there. Okay, at nearer input, we have some kind of problem. So by noticing that one, we can identify that, yes, language constructs or language syntax that I'm using correctly or not. Okay, so the language constructs or language syntax that I need to follow. So I want to save this one. So after saving this one, I did not find any kind of errors. Okay, so that is what I can see here. There is no errors in this one. Fine. Now, after completion of this one, what I should do? After completion of this one, what should I do? I need to synthesize my code. Okay, whether it is synthesizable or not. That means it has to generate the hardware or maybe a program. Normally, this tool cannot produce the gate level netlist for this circuit. Only it will produce the the circuit. Okay, so just to open the in a given RTL analysis in the flow navigator, you can see RTL analysis. Double click on open elaborate. Just open elaborate. Just click on OK. Yeah. According to your program, it has to generate the hardware. It has to generate the circuit. Okay, that is what it has to do. Okay, so this is how it is generating the hardware. According to the program, according to whatever the program that you have done, so according to your program, it chooses the components, exclusion OR gate it has taken, OR gate it has taken. In addition to that one, it is producing some buffers. Input output buffers are available, so don't bother about this one. To increase the driving capability of the outputs, it uses the buffers. Okay, nothing more than that. Okay, so it is producing the hardware, something like this. Now we need to simulate our design. Okay, so in order to simulate our design, what should we do? So in order to simulate our design, go to the add source again in the project manager, create a stimulus file. So I'm going to create a stimulus file. Here you can see the simulation file. Okay, go to the next, go to I have to create that one. So create a file. In this create a file, test underscore HA. After I want to test, right? Okay, that's what I want to do. Give the name. So this is also a wedlock file. Just to finish that one. Okay, so I don't want to give any input and outputs here. Okay, don't want to use values. So you can see here in the simulation, this is the source file of HopRadar. And the simulation file is available here. So test underscore HA. Okay, in this test underscore H, you can find again the skeleton here. Okay, so that means here we need to write again the input and output, everything. So no need to write input and output, right? Because a test bench, I don't want to use this one. I told you in the class that how do we write a test bench for this one. Okay, inputs are represented by register data type, A comma B. Okay, so the outputs are represented by Y type, S comma C. Okay, next, what is the component instantiation of adder? The module number one. Available things are A comma, B comma, S comma, C, right? So that's it. Next, I need to initialize the input vectors. I'm writing the input vectors. Of course, these things are not necessary. I want to delete. Okay, so that you can understand clearly. See, the begin I'm going to use. Begin. A equal to 0, okay, B equal to 1, sorry, 0, for example, equal to 0, okay, after 1 nanosecond, after 1 nanosecond, A equal to 0, but B is equal to 1, okay, so like this, so many test vectors I need to write, but because of lack of time, I'm not doing that one, okay. After 5 nanoseconds, for example, I want to, n is not required. After 5 nanoseconds, A equal to, sorry, I want to stop the simulation. Dollar stop simulation. Okay. So I need to end this module. Okay. And I need to write initial. I want to monitor the thing. Okay. Dollar monitor. Dollar monitor. Okay, I want to monitor the things, something like this. Okay, for example, time I want to see. Time. This time not. Time. Okay, and then I need to start. Stream A is equal to something. It's a percentage of B. B equal to percentage of B. S is equal to percentage of B. C equal to percentage of B. So this is what I want to see. So A comma, B comma, S comma, C. Okay, these are the things. So whatever the string that I have written in the double quotes, that will be seen at your screen monitor. Okay, finally we need to end this one. So I want to save this one. I hope no errors are there. Yes, it won't show you any kind of error. But interestingly, you can see the test bench is the top module and submodule is half adder. Now this is the correct process that you are doing now. Okay, then just we can simulate this one by using the behave run simulation in the flow navigator. Just double click on this one and run behavioral simulation. Okay, it will show you an output according to your test vectors. It is called behavioral simulation. So far we are doing the behavioral simulation, not post-sensor simulation and not timing simulation. Okay, so okay, fine. So this is what the output you can see. So there. So at 1 nanosecond, you considered here at before 1 nanosecond, A is equal to B is equal to 0. After 1 nanosecond, A is equal to 0, B is equal to 1. So after 5 nanosecond, the simulation will be stopped. Okay, after 5 nanoseconds, till 5 nanoseconds, this will be the same result. So this is how we need to check our simulation. Okay. You can also see the information. So you can see the text information in this way also. Okay. So at 0 nanosecond, A is equal to 0, B is equal to 0, sum 0, carry 0. At 1 nanosecond, A is equal. This is the exact statement I have given in monitor statement. So the same way it is producing the thing. Okay. So with this, how do we simulate our design by using the FPGA design flow we have seen. Okay, thank you very much. We will see the remaining things in the next class. Yeah, I will post all these things in the, I will upload all these things. Thank you.
Sir, upload the last two videos in the YouTube.
Okay, I'll do it.
Okay, sir.